Welcome back. In the previous lecture, I discussed the prominence of ICT, interoperability challenges, and the need for information architectures for guiding IT infrastructure developments. In this lecture, you will learn some of the basic elements of information or information technology architectures which can help you to get grip on the IT developments. I will first talk about the past, how we ended up at this situation, then about the present, and finally, I will discuss IT architectures to craft the future. Individual departments and organizations continue to make local design decisions influencing the whole system. By each decision, the system is evolutionarily changed. The theoretical concept of path dependency and management by magazines are important concepts in understanding how we arrived at the current fragmented landscape. Path-dependent histories are related to the available alternatives which are influenced by the existing situation and how decisions were made in the past. Path dependencies take into account past decisions based on the established institutional patterns and structures. A lot of IT decisions are based on management by magazine. Managers read about the possible benefits of technology in a periodical and follow what they read without making a business case. However, if you make a wrong IT decision, it will hunt you for years. The decisions made in the past are often made independent of each other. In this way, more and more systems become part of the IT landscape. These systems need to be interoperable to be able to exchange information with each other. Over time, more and more systems are connected to each other, resulting in a spaghetti of systems. One major issue is the loss of flexibility due to this complexity. Simple questions like which information is correct, which systems are connected to each other, can we add new functionality without affecting other systems, cannot be answered anymore. Flexibility is crucial to respond to technology developments or to the changing needs or requirements outside the scope a system was intended for. IT architecture should help to disentangle the situation by getting grip on the spaghetti and directing developments towards an ordered structure. IT architecture is the art and science of structuring and organizing information and systems. Traditional project planning and control tools are generally unsuitable for dealing with the complexity in open systems. There are simply too many interconnected or interwoven parts. New instruments and tools for managing the evolving IT landscape are required. We cannot engineer the situation and it's simply too complex. There are many players having limited authority, different requirements, a variety of systems, and so on. Instead of engineering, we have to architect. Architecting focuses on ill-structured problems. The situation is that there is no optimum, but we can use heuristics to improve the landscape. Heuristics refer to the use of past experience to arrive at suitable solutions. A well-known example of heuristics is to keep the IT landscape as simple as possible. Keep it simple. Information architectures should be used to create a shared view on what the future landscape should look like. We cannot change the entire landscape at once. We need time to realize this. Let's take a look at architecture development. IT architecture should provide a helicopter point of view. In our view, IT architecture is an abstract description of the reality and can be used as a frame of reference to guide design and development efforts. A descriptive architecture is an abstract representation of the existing IT infrastructure. We can't change the landscape at once. We know in advance that our plans will not be realized as intended. A prescriptive architecture outlines the desired situation and is the result of design efforts. Often prescriptive architectures are staged. Short-term views are more concrete and the long-term view is more like a vision. Implementing efforts are aimed at improving parts of the IT infrastructure and take into account the descriptive and prescriptive architectures. In turn, implementation projects change the infrastructure and therefore the descriptive architecture needs to be updated. The experience and results of the design projects and resulting infrastructure influence the prescriptive architecture. Because new standards, architectural principles, reusable building blocks, and so on are created in those design projects. Finally, the effort should result in a next generation IT infrastructure. Architecture is an abstraction of the existing IT infrastructure and the next generation of IT infrastructure. A good architecture contains both descriptive and prescriptive elements. I want to discuss layered architectures, views, and principles. Layers are a way to deal with complexity. Views should ensure that important concerns like flexibility and security are addressed, and principles provide direction. How are we going to deal with the complexity? We have software applications, modules, databases, operating systems, communication protocol, pieces of hardware, and so on. As you can see on the left-hand side, those elements are heterogeneous. It's hard to see any of those elements in this jungle. One way of dealing with this vast complexity is by introducing layers. And then organizing the elements using those layers. As you see, this already looks more organized. There are a number of reasons for using a layered architecture. Layers can be used to deal with the complexity by organizing similar entities in one layer. Each layer can be analyzed and designed independently of the other layers. Nevertheless, there is a risk that you don't see the dependencies between layers. For example, two databases do not seem to be connected when looking at one layer. But a dependency exists in the business process layer. Business processes might use both databases at the same time. As such, always ensure that you consider the dependencies among layers. Do you need to use 5 layers as in our example? No, you can customize the layers for the problem at hand. I've seen variations between 3 and 15 layers. If you're feeling it's not organized that well yet, it's possible to use hierarchical decomposition. This is the process of decomposing a system in a top-down fashion by dividing elements into sub-elements. Within a layer, one can start at a high level of abstraction and then zoom in to a more detailed level. Often the focus of IT architecting is on a limited number of layers, not on all of them at the same time. The layers are aimed at creating coherency. However, they do not include various views on the system, like the user, developer, or security view. These views typically go beyond a single layer and can be added as a vertical column. IEEE 1471 defines a view as part of an architecture description, targeted at specific concerns. A view is what you see, looking from the perspective of the stakeholders and his or her concern. You can use a view within a layer, but often a view is used across all layers. For instance, security is relevant at all levels. When we look at this example, you still see that the lower layer contains the physical energy infrastructure and the layers on top the elements of the IT infrastructure. This looks already pretty structured and systematic and can also help you to describe the existing and the desired situation. Blank spots can be discovered by comparing the existing with the desired situation. We can use principles to give direction to the architecture developments. Principles are useful when it comes to solving ill-structured or complex problems. The Open Group have defined design principles as general rules and guidelines that are intended to be enduring and seldom amended, that inform and support the way in which an organization sets about fulfilling its missions. Principles are heuristics or rules of thumb. They guide actions and are meant to direct. Principles are often normative or prescriptive in nature. Principles emphasize doing the right things. The Open Group Architecture Forum provides templates for describing principles. In these templates, principles are described by a name, a statement, a brief explanation of its rationale, and its implications of following the principle. A principle will be easier accepted and remembered if you explain why a principle is relevant and what benefits it might bring. That's why principles are sometimes illustrated by a picture, to show the essence. Some examples of principles for creating flexibility in IT architectures are the use of standardized interfaces for building blocks. If interfaces do not change, building blocks can be replaced by other building blocks without affecting the system. To ensure that the interfaces are stable, the complexity should be within a module. Service-oriented architectures are often used for creating modular architectures. To ensure that building blocks are not too dependent on each other, it's good to include buffers, or so-called decoupling points, between them. The buffer will store the messages exchanged between building blocks and ensures continuity when one building block is temporarily not functioning. These principles will likely result in more flexibility. But don't fall into the trap of having too many principles. People will not remember them. In summary, IT architecting is the art and science of structuring and organizing information and systems. In this lecture, some instruments were provided to disentangle in IT infrastructure using layered architectures, views, and principles. There's a whole world behind this that can be further explored. If you want to manage IT infrastructures and its complexity, knowledge about IT infrastructures is key. Thank you for your attention.